Hello students, so welcome back to my video. So I think this is a video part number 9 for you, right? Okay, now in this video I'm going to discuss the concept called relativistic variation of mass with velocity. So far we have understood that mass of a body, okay, if we consider mass of a body, it is always an invariant quantity according to Newtonian mechanics and even according to Galilean transformation equation also. So, we have the knowledge that mass of a body is always constant. It is a invariant quantity, right? Now, according to the special theory of relativity in which we are coming across the Lorentz transformation equations, so one can prove that mass of a body is also a variant quantity. Okay, relative measurement of a mass of a body is always not constant. It is not absolute measurement, okay? So, depending upon the measured observer, whether he is measuring with respect to is one frame of reference or measurement by an observer who is in the stationary frame of reference. Okay, depending upon that, okay, the mass of the body is can be defined here. Okay, whether it is a constant for both observers or it is different for different observers. In that way, so we can prove that mass of a body is not an absolute quantity, it is a variant quantity. That is why it is called relativistic mass. It is called relativistic mass. Clear? So, in order to prove that relativistic variation of mass, so when it is moving with certain velocity, so as usual, what we have to consider? So, you know that, so we should consider basically two frames of reference, correct? So, these are the two frames of reference you can see here. So, S is the fixed frame of reference, okay, we have the rectangular frame of reference like X, Y and Z here, okay, X, Y, Z. Similarly, X dash is coinciding with X axis for the frame of reference S dash, okay. So, this frame of reference is defined as X dash, Y dash and Z dash, where S dash is a moving frame of reference. It is always considered as moving uniformly with velocity V with respect to the frame of reference S, correct? Okay, now in this two frames of reference, so you have to prove the mass of a body is always considered as varying with respect to one of the observer. So, let us consider not only one body. First, what you have to consider here is two bodies. So, I am considering here two bodies A and B, namely bodies A and B of masses corresponding mass are M1 and M2. Should remember that the two bodies are now with respect to the frame of reference S dash. Okay, you are considering the two bodies in the frame of reference S dash, and that masses are not considered as constant here. So, first of all you have to assume that the masses of the bodies in the frame of reference are moving in the opposite direction. You can see the arrow mark here. Okay, so body A is moving in the direction left to right, whereas the body B is moving from the right to left. Okay, so once they move in the opposite direction, what happens? So after certain time, immediately they will collide. Okay, so the collision takes place between the two bodies. So they can coalesce into each other also. So that the total mass of the body becomes now M1 plus M2. So before collision, they are separate masses M1 and M2. Once they collide, you can consider that two bodies will coalesce each other, and the total mass will become M1 plus M2, okay. So, that total mass again with respect to moving frame of reference S dash is constant because it is with the frame of reference S dash. So, it has to be constant with respect to S dash. So, whereas with respect to the observer in the frame S, what happens? Frame S dash itself is moving, and hence the total mass M1 M2 after collision also moving with the same velocity of the frame S dash, okay. So, with that concept, so we can prove that mass of a body with respect to frame of reference S is not constant, okay, as observed by S dash. So, that is what you have to obtain theoretically. So, let us see what is the theoretical equation for that by assuming this kind of two frames of reference with two bodies A and B now, okay. So, let us proceed with that now. So, what are the basic things I am considering here? So, S and S dash, okay, be the two inertial frames, okay, in which S dash is particularly moving with the uniform velocity V bar, correct? So, note down this point. So, next point is, as I am considering two bodies A and B, what are the masses? M1 and M2 be the masses of two rigid bodies A and B, clear? And then moving in opposite directions, I told they are not at rest, they are moving in the opposite direction with the velocities. What are the velocities of the two masses now with respect to S dash? So, you have to give the velocity, you know. So, let us assume that as U dash, okay, and moving in other body moving in the opposite direction, I will write it as minus U dash, clear? So, U dash and minus U dash are the velocities of two bodies moving in the opposite direction, okay, in the frame s dash. Oh, what is the total momentum before collision? So before collision, as they are moving in the opposite direction, momentum cancel each other, you know, and hence the total momentum before collision is zero. Is it clear? Okay, now let us consider after collision what happens. See, after collision the two balls coalesce into a single mass. Coalesce means just like superposition of two bodies into each other, so that is called coalesce into a single mass. Okay, they become increasing their mass. M1 plus M2 is the total mass. Okay, so that will appear to move with the velocity v bar. So once they coalesce each other, then the total mass, okay, that is a solid body of the coalesced mass between the two bodies are moving with respect to frame of reference, that is v bar. So because that is the velocity of the frame s dash, you know, the same velocity the coalesced mass is also moving with respect to s, as I told already. Clear? So now once you understand this concept, so I will proceed with the equations in the special theory of relativity. So what are the equations we need? So according to inverse Lorentz transformations, we have to consider now, you know already what is Lorentz transformation equations and inverse Lorentz transformation equation for a moving body, right? So now according to inverse Lorentz transformations, the velocity of the balls A and B, okay, relative to the frame S, because they are in the frame S dash. So relative to S, we have the equation for any body moving in the frame S dash. So that velocity is given by now for the body A. So U1 is equal to, so it is moving the velocity U dash, okay, plus frame velocity V, divided by 1 plus V into U dash by C square, correct? So we are considering the velocity of the frame and velocity of the moving body, that is U dash. So same equation, how do you write for the body B, which is moving in the opposite direction? So that is U2. Okay, U2 is equal to now minus U dash plus V. Why? You have to consider here minus U dash, because it is moving in the opposite direction, minus U. So U minus U dash, divided by here again minus U dash. If you substitute it here, it will get minus again here. So 1 minus, you will get V into U dash divided by C square. So write down these two basic equations of the velocity of the body A and velocity of the body B, okay, relative to the frame S now. Okay, according to inverse Lorentz transformations. Okay. Now look at here. After collision, as I told, the two balls will be at rest in S dash. Correct? With respect to S dash, they are at rest. But what about for the observer S? Okay, observer S, they appear to be moving with a velocity V, isn't it? With respect to observer S, they are moving with velocity of the moving frame of reference S dash, so that is V. Okay, then you have to apply the law of conservation. Using the law of conservation, we have the equation like this. When the bodies are moving with the velocity U1 and U2 separately, so corresponding mass are M1 and M2. So therefore, the product of masses and mass and the velocity, okay, for both the bodies, so can be considered as the total momentum, right? So M1 U1 plus M2 U2 when they before collision. So after collision, the total mass is considered as M1 plus M2. And moving with what velocity? They are not moving with velocity U1 and U2. They are moving with the velocity V. Okay. So you have to multiply by V now. Right? Okay. So note down this equation first. Then you have to simplify. So you can take M1 common because we have M1 into U1 here. And here also we have M1 into V. Okay. If you take it on side, you will get M1 common into M1 minus V, as it is coming in the left hand side. So M1 into V becomes minus. So minus V is the factor here. Similarly, if you take M2 common in the other side, you will get V and minus U2. So this comes in the right hand side, you will get V minus U2. Clear? So look at this mathematical step and make a simple simplification here. Then, so what I want here is basically the ratio of masses. So how do you do it? M1 by M2. Okay, take M1 by M2 is equal to, so this V minus U2 divided by this U1 minus V in the denominator. Clear? So that is the equation 4 for your reference. Clear? Okay, so this is very important equation for M1 by M2 is equal to V minus U2 divided by U1 minus V. Okay, then let us substitute the known equations from equation 1 and 2. So look at the equations 1 and 2, substituting the values of U1 and U2 from equation 1 and 2 into the equation 4. Clear? So what we get? So just I am substituting the u1 and u2 from equation 1 and 2. So that is v minus, so u2 is equal to what? Minus u dash plus v divided by 1 minus v into u dash by c square. Similarly, here you have u1, isn't it? So u1 equation is u dash plus v divided by 1 plus v u dash by c square. So minus v as it is, right? So just substitute u1 and u2 from equation 1 and 2. That's it here. Clear? Then on simplification, mathematical simplification you have to do here. What is that? See, here we have the LCM 1 minus v u dash by c square. Similarly, we have the LCM here 1 plus v u dash by c square. So take the LCM for both. Okay, this is LCM, this is LCM here. Okay, but this LCM will come to numerator and this LCM will come to denominator. So when you make the mathematical simplification, so that is what I am writing here. Okay, see, v minus v square u dash by c square minus of, isn't it, minus u dash plus v. Okay, so within this bracket minus u dash plus v is there, and then close the big bracket, and this LCM, whatever the LCM we get here, you know, 1 plus v u dash by c square, I am taking into the now numerator part. So that is 1 plus v u dash by c square. Similarly, after taking the LCM for this one, okay, this denominator I will write it in the denominator part, like for multiplication of this one. So that is u dash plus v minus v plus v square u dash by c square. Okay, so that is what I am considering in the flower bracket. So after that, this denominator, as I told, 1 minus v u dash by c square written here, 1 minus v u dash by c square. Okay, so that you can check in your rough book, the calculation part. Okay, so after that simple simplification, so I will proceed here. How I am proceeding? See, there is a cancellation part of the equation. So what is that cancellation part? Say we can cancel v and this minus v, correct, in the above equation. So that we left with only minus v square u dash by c square. Okay, that is minus into minus plus u dash, clear, and into as it is 1 plus v u dash by c square. Similarly, look at the denominator part. So what is the cancellation term? So that is again plus v and minus v cancel each other. Okay, left with u dash minus v square u dash by c square from this term, correct, so with negative sign of course, into 1 minus v u dash by c square. Okay, so that I am not disturbing here, again as it is I am writing in the second part of the bracket. Okay, so this is the equation 5. So write down up to equation 5, then I will proceed for the simplification. So that equation 5, I am rewriting again here. See, m1 by m2 is equal to, so the equation can be written like this, u dash minus v square u dash by c square. Okay, so into 1 plus v u dash by c square. Okay, so divided by, again we have u dash minus v square u dash by c square into 1 minus v u dash by c square, correct. So then now we can see that similarities are there here. So these two are similar to each other, so that, so you can cancel the entire term, right. So then what is left with the equation? Only this part, 1 plus v u dash by c square divided by 1 minus v u dash by c square, correct. So take this as equation 6 for you. Okay, after cancelling these two terms, you can get the equation 6. Clear? Okay. Now, so leave this equation up to 6, and then to get the same equation to substitute here, so like for m1, m2, so we have to consider some terms here. What is the term? So consider the term like 1 minus u1 square by c square, so that we can substitute the equation of u1 and simplify. Okay. See, we have the equation for u1. So you take the whole square of that. So that is equal to 1 minus u1 square by c square is equal to 1 minus. Okay. So look at the equation for u1 and then substitute. U dash plus v by c whole square you will get, divided by 1 plus v u dash by c square into whole square. Okay. So this is what actually obtained from equation u1. Okay. Then simplification of this term. So what is the simplification of this term? How do you do it? So this is actually 1 plus v u dash by c square whole square, isn't it? So that means you have to assume that it is like a plus b whole square. So if I take that splitting up of the equation like a plus b whole square, you will get a square plus b square plus 2ab, right? So that part I will write it now, multiplying with this one when you take the LCM of this one. Okay, so take this LCM as 1 plus V u dash by c square whole square first. Then write down the splitting up of this equation here. That is 1 plus V square u dash square plus c square is there, isn't it? C square whole square, that is c to the power of 4 plus, okay, 2ab. So that is 2 into V u dash by c square. So that is a plus a square plus b square plus 2ab is over here. Similarly, so what we have here, see, u dash plus v by c whole square, that is like a u dash by c plus v by c. So you can take it as again a plus b whole square. So write down the formula for that again. So u dash by c whole square, okay, that is b square is now v square by c square minus 2ab means 2 into u dash v by c. So 2 into v dash u dash by c square, of course it is. Okay, so that means, so you are getting c into c, you know, that is c square here, right? Now if I look at this equation, we have the common term like to cancel. So 2v u dash by c square and 2v u dash by c square. This is with negative sign, this is with positive sign. So cancel each other, okay? After the cancellation, what is left with? So left with this term with the some common term, right? So v square by c square is here and v square by c to the power of 4 here. So that you can take the common v square by c square as common here, okay? Then proceed here, see that is 1 minus u dash square by c square, right? So I am writing that term first here, correct? Minus v square by c square, as I told, it is taken common, v square by c square is taken common, okay? So minus v square by c square is taken common, left with 1 here, okay? That is 1 minus, so that is left with u dash square divided by c to the power of 4 was there, isn't it? So I take only c square as common, that is why left with only u dash square by c square in the denominator. Clear? Okay, so in the denominator, so LCM term was there, 1 plus v u dash by c square whole square as it is. Okay, now so here you can observe that here 1 plus u dash square by c square, 1 minus u dash square by c square, so both are same. So you can take common again in the numerator part, that is 1 minus u dash square by c square is common, left with 1 minus v square by c square, correct? So denominator is same, 1 plus v u dash by c square whole square. So that is the equation 7. So the equation 7 is obtained by considering the term 1 minus u1 dash by c square, remember it, okay? So now in place of u1, if I take u2, so you know the equation for u1 and u2, right? If I take u2, so you can get the similar equation. So only thing, wherever we have v, you have to substitute at minus v, that's it, isn't it? So that's why similarly 1 minus u2 square by c square, similar to this, we have 1 minus u2 square by c square is equal to, so no change in the numerator part here. So 1 minus, okay, v square by c square into 1 minus u dash square by c square, correct? But in the denominator we have v here, plus v, so you'll get minus v here. So 1 minus v u dash by c square whole square, that is only the difference between the equation 7 and now this is equation 8, correct? So numerator is same, only denominator with negative sign here, that's it. Okay, now once we have the equation 7 and 8, so you have to proceed by dividing equation 8 by equation 7, okay? Because you have to get the equation like similar to this equation 6, so in order to get the similar equation, we are doing all this circus here, okay? So dividing equation 8 by equation 7, what you will get? So let us proceed that one now. So note down the equation up to 8. Okay, here I am doing that dividing equation 8 by equation 7. So look at it here. So that is 1 minus u2 square by c square, right? So that is actually equation 8. Dividing by equation 7 means equation 7 left hand side, we have 1 plus 1 minus u1 square by c square, right? Similarly in the right hand side, so you can divide like equation 8 by equation 7, I told, no? So these terms you can cancel after dividing. So this is 1 minus u1 dash square by c square into 1 minus v square by c square. So same terms are there in the numerator here also, so that you can cancel these two terms. So left with only the denominators, but when you divide, you will get 1 plus v u dash by c square whole square, okay? So this denominator will come to the numerator part when you divide equation 8 by equation 7. So and then this denominator will come in the Yeah, 1 minus v u dash by c square whole square. Okay, so look at the equations carefully. So when you divide 8 by 7, this numerator will cancel completely, left with only denominators in this form. Okay, 1 plus v u dash by c square whole square, whole divided by 1 minus v u dash by c square whole square. Okay, now what is the next simplification part? So here we have numerator and denominator, both are squares. Okay, if I take square root on both sides, okay, that is taking square root on both sides. So taking square roots on both sides, you will get only this part, 1 plus v u dash by c square here. Okay, I'm just rearranging the equation. This right side term, I'm writing left hand side, that's it. 1 minus v u dash by c square, whole square will go because taking square root on both sides. So is equal to this side, we have to put the square root, that is square root of the same term you write, 1 minus u2 whole square by c square, whole divided by 1 minus u1 square by c square. Okay, then you will get one equation called 9. Let it be equation 9 for you. Okay, now what is the next simplification? So we have to substitute this 1 plus v u dash by c square, 1 minus v u dash by c square into the equation 6, because this is the equation 6 gives the ratio m1 by m2, right? Now let us see that part in the right hand side. Okay, the continuation is substituting equation 9 in equation 6. So we have the term similar here, isn't it, in equation 6 and 9. So 1 plus v u dash by c square, 1 minus v u dash by c square, and we here also we have same 1 plus v u dash by c square divided by 1 minus v u dash by c square. Okay, so but this value is actually found to be square root of 1 minus u 2 square by c square whole divided by 1 minus u 1 square by c square. Okay, you can take this value as the ratio m1 by m2 by comparing this equation 6 and 9. So I can write now m1 by m2 is equal to square root of the same equation, like 1 minus u2 square by c square whole divided by 1 minus u1 square by c square. The entire thing is within the big square root here. Okay, now so by cross multiplication we can write now m1 into this, the square root of the denominator is square root of 1 minus u1 square by c square. Similarly m2 into this value, so m2 into square root of 1 minus u2 square by c square, that's it. So now we have some constant quantity here. So it is appearing that for m1 you are multiplying its velocity u1, for m2 you are multiplying with its velocity u2, right? So but c is the velocity of light. Okay, so this term is constant in both sides. So except that it appears to be constant depending upon the value of m1 and u1, m2, u2. So it is independent, right? So and hence we can consider the terms are equivalent in the sense it is some constant. Okay, that constant is considered as here the rest mass of the body when the two masses are coalesced each other. So the body appears to be at rest. Okay, it is with a zero velocity, not moving with some velocity with respect to frame of reference s dash. Okay, so let us take that constant like this. Okay, the two sides of equation 10 are independent of each other, therefore each term must be equal to some constant. Okay, some constant again, some constant here. So that constant is taken as here m naught. Okay, so these two equations are equal to some constant m naught, and where m naught is the constant called rest mass of the body. Okay, so we have to consider that constant as rest mass of the body when the body is at rest with respect to moving frame of reference. Clear? So I can write the equation for m1 and m2 like this, isn't it, by cross multiplication. So m1 is equal to, you will get m0 by square root of 1 minus u1 square by c square, and m2 is equal to m0 by square root of 1 minus u2 square by c square. So where u1 and u2 are there corresponding velocities, right? So these common equations for m1 and m2 we can generalize also for any particle of mass m, let us say moving with velocity some velocity u. So how do you write the equation? So in general, if m denotes the mass of the body moving with the velocity v, let us say, so instead of u I can take some velocity v. Okay, v, then you can write the relativistic mass. Now we get the relativistic mass equation, like m is equal to m naught by square root of 1 minus v square by c square. Okay, so when you consider two separate bodies, the velocity of the bodies are assumed as u1 and u2. So when it is found to be similar, equal to each other, then you can generalize like this. So that equation is called relativistic mass equation for you, right? So should remember the equation for m is equal to m0, where m0 is rest mass of the body when it is not moving. Okay, so same body when it is moving with some velocity v, okay, its mass becomes m, but m is not equal to m0. You should remember that m is not equal to m0. So m is actually greater than m0 because of this denominator, square root of 1 minus v square by c square, you know. So this factor will reduce the mass of the body. Okay, so moving body will have larger mass. So this is the relativistic formula for the variation of mass with velocity, right? So then finally we can conclude again. Suppose if you compare this velocity v of the particle to the velocity of light, so what will happen if I take v is equal to c, let us say. So if v is equal to c, so it cancels each other, 1 minus 1 you will get 0, okay, and m0 by 0 something you will get infinity value. So m is equal to infinity, right? So which is impossible. So that means v cannot be equal to c. And similarly, suppose if I assume theoretically v is greater than c, particle is moving with greater velocity than the velocity of light, then what happens in this equation? You will get some imaginary term, right? So m becomes imaginary, so which is also not possible, right? So that means v cannot be equal to c, v cannot be greater than c. So particle, any particle cannot move with the velocity c or greater than c. That is what you can write in the conclusion here. So hence material particle, any material particle cannot have velocity equal to or greater than velocity of light. Okay, so that is what you have to understand here. So from this equation, what you will understand basically, so this shows that the mass of a body moving with velocity v nearly equal to c, you should say, but not equal to c or not greater than c, nearly equal to c, but relative to an observer, that is a fixed observer, is always larger than its rest mass. That means m is always greater than m0, you should remember. Okay, so with what factor it is greater? That is by the factor 1 by square root of this denominator term, 1 by 1 minus v square by c square term. Okay, so that is what all about the relativistic mass equation according to the special theory of relativity. And then you can finally say that any mass of the particle cannot be considered as a fixed quantity for any observer. Okay, it is depending upon the observer, and hence we can consider it as a variable quantity. Okay, it is not a invariant quantity, it is a variant quantity also. That's it. Okay, see you in the next video then.